He is a lecturer in UCLA, and I think he also did his PhD from there, and he's in the Department of Geography. So he can speak more about himself.
I'll say a few words just so you have some sense of where I am and actually why I asked also to have this kind of dialogue with you. So first I want to thank Chandrama for arranging this and thanks to you also for coming out. My goal is to learn a bit more about Ulaanbaatar through the process of showing you the examples of urban settlement patterns where I had done my PhD work, which is Mongolia, Ulaanbaatar. And as Chandrama mentioned, I teach half the year at UCLA, but the other half of the year is this traveling program where we're here with students, some of them Indian, some from other places in the world, but mostly from the US, and all of them attend university in the United States. And we've taken them out of that environment and put them into the places that we actually study across the global south. So this is now the third of a series of dialogues that I've tried to schedule in each of the cities that we've been in, which is going from New York to São Paulo in Brazil and Cape Town, South Africa, because each city has its own unique patterns, but there's still this issue between informal settlement and housing and how one gets over this process, especially managing through governmentality and how central governments have approached this issue. So the reason I'm giving this talk is actually to show you or illustrate one version of things, what I learned through my PhD, but then to try and have more of a dialogue about what you see of housing here in Ahmedabad or in India, in Indian cities in general, or any cities that you happen to know a lot more about. So maybe with that I can actually just start in. And just any quick questions to begin with? No? We're all good. Okay, if there are questions, please do raise your hand and ask me as I go. What I'm planning to do is go through and talk for about 45 minutes. I tend to be a little bit long-winded. It's that professorial habit. But what I'm planning to do is first just describe the places where I'm working in Mongolia, what these settlement areas look like and how they've come about, say a little bit about their history, say a little bit about my own working methods, that I have basically three methods that are part of the collection of data, participant observation, living with a family, doing a very general survey, and then having more detailed conversations but with a smaller pool of people. And each of those methods is pretty integral to the story that I'm telling because it gets at a particular picture as well. I have to move this back. Okay, so what you are seeing here is quite literally the edge of Ulaanbaatar. It's a city that is composed of about 1.3 million people, so not large in say Indian or most world city terms, but it's a primate city of Mongolia. It is many times larger than the next settlement size. So 1.3 million in Mongolian terms is it's more than a third. It's a little less than half the entire Mongolian population. Overall, Mongolia is it's counted as about 50% urbanized, and almost all of that would be Ulaanbaatar, just the next few settlements then make up the rest of that 50%. And that means that half the country of just under 3 million, about 2.7 million, half the country remains nomadic and locked into this pastoral nomadic system of economic production, and that has some kind of meaning as we go forward in looking at houses. So what you're seeing here is quite literally the edge of the city, and the form of settlement here are these what are called kasha, or fenced-in yards, and I'll show you some of the typical houses. And obviously that's that kind of God's eye planner's view that we tend to have. when we're looking at things in a professional way, but I also want to get into the ethnographic, meaning the ground view. So that's that same neighborhood as you'd see it from the ground. Now the typical house, it's called a ger, G-E-R, or sometimes in you'll see it in the Kyrillic or the Russian as a yurt. In Mongolian, typically called a ger, and it looks like this. Essentially, it's a lower structure that's framed with an expanding fence, and then struts that come off of a central crown that's held up by two struts, and then usually in the summer covered in a thinner fabric, and in the winter there'd be layers of felt, of wool, to provide the insulation. And I used this image, I took this about 15 years ago there, because it shows both that kind of classical ethnographic view, in sepia tones no less, where you have that what's called the urg, the pole that's used by the horsemen to lasso the sheep, but on the other hand you also have another hoop there, speaking towards the modernity. And there's a real sense in the countryside of a connection to the city that that they, though it seems quite isolated out here, there's a real sense that they are connected both to the city and to the world, that they do get television and are aware of world events. And I bring that up because then there's the other image, which is the city, and this kind of image no longer exists of the ger juxtaposed against the buildings, but what does happen now is there is a core or central city which is built up of those concrete block buildings, and the periphery, the entire peripheral area, tends to be made up of ger with these chasha fences, which are slowly being replaced by fixed dwellings, but individual detached houses within these yards that are a different form of housing, still considered an informal form of housing compared to those concrete block structures. The curious thing about Ulaanbaatar is we often have the conception of these block buildings that were all came up during the socialist era, according to sort of Soviet plans. And it was, in fact, Soviet planners that had planned these out. And there's something nice and regular about the super quadras as they've been laid out. And the tendency now is to think of this as the core city or the built portion of the city, and then this as the periphery that's come up informally since then. Whereas, actually, this is a historic photo from the Urban Planning Department of Ulaanbaatar. At the time that these concrete blocks had been constructed through the 1950s and 1960s, and they are replacing a city that had already existed in what we call the informal, but had been there prior. And this is just one district, but had you looked across the entire city, the whole city had been planned out as concrete block replacement of existing informal settlement. This happens to be one of the places where I ended up living, in one of the concrete block structures. It was the very last one that was constructed under state socialism, which collapsed in Mongolia in 1991. So this was the very last large-scale development. And 1991 is also seen as a bit of the pivot point at which the control of people moving from the rural to the urban, those kinds of controls under state socialism were released. People then became much more mobile, and that was really the kind of the higher gear of rural to urban settlement patterns, or rural to urban migration and then settlement. So 1991 is seen as in some ways the end of this form of housing and the beginning of this form, forgetting that this informal settlement had occurred well before the block buildings arrived. And as much as those block buildings have some kind of regularity, I'm going to talk about informal and the rules of informality to suggest that there's a whole new set of rules there that also move towards formality, except that they happen at a ground level or a grassroots up. So it's not a top-down form of organization, but it's a kind of planning that does come about, but each individual homeowner, each lot owner, is a participant in this system, creating what is, in fact, a fairly regular plan. Of course, if you saw this at the street, it wouldn't look quite as regularized, but just looking at it from above, you do get the sense that there is some regularity to this plan. Okay. To give you just some very quick sense of what the map looks like here, the core city is this, and this would be the area that was first built up under Soviet planners, and then those wings off to each end. And the photo that I showed you, the historic image, would have been this wing coming up and becoming part of the city. But the sprawl now of all of that rural to urban settlement has spread out, and you can see the topography plays a large role in this, that essentially in the valleys where the roads go is also where people begin to settle. And nothing surprising in that, that informal settlements happen where there's access. And one of the key findings from the survey that I did with a partner was that one of the primary desires of individual homeowners out in the Gare districts or in these informal settlements was access to the center. That would become one of the main culprits in the rising value of real estate property, even in informal districts. I have four names up here that at some point I might refer to these, but they're not that important to the substance of the talk. But these are the principal four areas where I was doing the research around the city. And what is more important is just to understand that this was an informal settlement that's been around or been in existence for at least 30 to 40 years, so well before the end of state-sponsored socialism. But the other three areas have each come up more recently. And the area that I ended up living in when I wasn't in a concrete block building was an informal settlement out here, the furthest one. And the very first images that I showed you of the edge of the city, that would be up here at this kind of northern edge, northwestern edge of the city. Okay. So I mentioned that I had three different ways of working that were primarily ethnographic. And ethnography and access is always a question, but my goal was actually to avoid that survey, which I will mention because it did become one key component. In fact, what I found was the ethnographic had to work with some grander scheme for understanding what was happening all across the city at this point. But the three areas or the three ways that I ended up working, one was the survey, the other was participant observation, essentially living with a family that turned out to be building their own home. And then this third piece that I'll go into a bit more detail towards the end, which was families that I interviewed in slightly greater depth than the survey instrument or the survey form was able to get at, but much fewer in number. I was only able to talk to about 15 families in this time frame. And of course, in depth living with a family, I was only able to do this with one family, the family that I lived with. But each of these is a scale picture of the city. So living with a family, of course, you're getting a very detailed picture, but you're limited to a single family and you want to know how does that fit in. Well, talking to about a little over a dozen families gives you a broader range of how people are doing, what people are doing, how they're building, how they're living. And of course, you want to fit that into that much larger picture across the whole city. So the survey instrument was the only one that looked across the city, The interviews looked at each of those four areas in particular, and then, of course, the ethnographic where I'm living was in Zunsala, the one city, the one district in the northwest. This happens to be a wedding that happened within that family. Okay, so I'll start off with the participant observation. I like this image just as a sort of a something that you can read across, because you have the play blocks in the center or in the foreground that of course are going to be foreshadowing the construction of a house. This is not a house, this is actually just a shed that they've used to keep their tools, mostly for the construction of a house. And the family at the time was living here in this gare. Of course, in the next image, the gare is gone because the house has been built and behind me. So I spent quite a bit of time, basically over the course of 6 months, living with this family. Although the house, much of the structure of the house had gone up before I'd arrived, so I was there through some of the completion of structure and then the finishing of interiors and the finishing of the house overall, but we spent several months, I should say about 6 weeks on the overall construction. It was actually a fairly quick process. They wanted to finish before the summer ends, and the summer pretty much ends August to early September, and temperatures begin dropping in September. And it can get quite cold. It can drop below zero centigrade by mid-September, and then 15 to 20 below by the end of September even. And there'll be nice moments where it gets warmer in October at, you know, for some days or something, but obviously the temperature is going to keep dropping and gets down to about 40 below, which by that point it doesn't matter if you're in centigrade or Fahrenheit scale. 40 below is cold, and that'll happen by the end of the year. So not quite yet, but within the next 3 weeks or so, it would probably hit those kinds of temperatures. And it doesn't stay there either. But the idea is one has to finish the house by September if you're going to move into it that year. It gets pretty hard to do much kind of work into the winter. I like to use Otko, the youngest daughter in the family, as something of a muse for this. Those were her play bricks that you saw earlier, those plastic ones, and the real bricks, which will this will become one of the very finishing touches, erecting some kind of entry into the house so you don't enter directly from the cold into the contained environment of the house. But all of this is really meant to be a parable of this very rapid form of construction. And going from these kinds of interiors, and it's a nice image because it does show that there's some consideration for how to build, meaning in these kinds of cold temperatures, they're doing a interlocking log form of construction for the exterior, and there's still some recognition of what kinds of heat barriers you would need interior-wise. And then this happens to be the housewarming day. This was, I believe it was, they did meet their deadline of mid-September. They had a housewarming party, but this is that same room finished. The exterior here, the day that they were fixing all of their equipment was because they're going to make some cuts into this space. And again, on the housewarming day, I took these images with the windows in place and the upper level mostly framed out, although it would not become habitable until the next year. I think this is Otko's own room, the youngest daughter. So where that window comes in is here, and on the housewarming day or the open house day, she had exhausted herself with the guests. So she's always there as something of a muse. And you can see obviously her bricks are now aligned. So the details of living with a family was really a great way of understanding this process and seeing how a house goes through the process of being constructed by its owners, right? There's no larger intervention from the state here. There's no developer, no professional contractors were involved in this process. These were people who had been pastoral nomads. This whole family had been pastoral nomadic and had moved to the city, and you'd think that people who've grown up their entire life setting up tents, how would they have the knowledge to build a house? But they do. They figure these things out. So that's a point that I'll come back to. Now, just talking very briefly about the survey, it was important to have because it covered a much wider base than a single family is able to do. On the other hand, I'll say a few things about the survey, which is that it was actually quite disappointing, and it was doubly disappointing. It was disappointing in basically two ways. Among the questions that we were asking, and this I should mention was done with a partner, Jean-Martin Calderon, who had experience doing surveys where I had not. And his point was to understand what the values were in these properties, and the conclusion really for him was this transport network, being able to access transportation was important. Really for me, the importance of this was how many people were building homes, how many people intended to build homes, how many people had access to the tools to build homes. And when I say tools, I don't mean the physical tools, I mean what are going to become economic and policy-oriented tools. And that's essentially where I'm headed with my talk, is to end up with those kinds of things. This was a gentleman who actually did live in the Gare, and we were able to talk about the house that was going up next door. So he's busy filling out the form. So it was a nice juxtaposition of these two extremes of housing, the fixed dwelling, in this case a fairly sizable version of that, and then a Gare that's getting kind of squeezed out. So when I say it was doubly disappointing, the first disappointment was that actually I found most people were not doing very well. Very few people had the means to change their situation. Of course, many wanted to upgrade, and those were their terms, upgrade from a Gare to a fixed dwelling. And that there were, in a survey of something like 140 families, there were only a handful that said, no, we're not interested in that. We're Mongolian, we live in a Gare. Most families who were living in Gare wanted to come into a fixed dwelling, and of course there were a number of fixed dwellings also in this survey. But it was deeply disappointing in that very few people had the access to do that. So that was the first disappointment. The second disappointment was actually a survey like this had been carried out by the National Statistical Office, and part of our test was to understand how good the numbers were from the National Statistical Office. And the disappointment was actually their numbers were pretty good. Our numbers tended to match fairly well with their numbers. And in a survey of 140 households, it doesn't give a great confidence interval, but it was sufficient to say that the numbers that the NSO was offering, the Mongolian state version of a statistical office, were actually sufficient. And there had been a number of questions about those numbers in previous people's work, but our numbers actually did align, and it gave us the ability to then trust other data that they had collected. So yeah, academically disappointing to not have covered new ground and not to have had something earth-shattering, and disappointing to find out that so few people had the ability to advance and become more urban. They'd come to the city to join the urban economy, but they didn't have a very good platform to stand on from their home base. However, there was one really good positive that came out of this, and the interview process was not something I had come to naturally. It was not part of my initial proposed methods. When you go off to do your PhD, of course, you propose what the methods are that you're going to use to get the data. And that had not been, I had not considered that as one of the main things that I would be using. But what came out of the survey was I found a lot of people who didn't find satisfactory answers in the survey instrument itself and wanted to have a deeper conversation about this. And I found that the survey instrument became the way into talking with more people that I would have had difficulty, I felt I would have had difficulty approaching on the street, but by going through the survey and identifying people who did want to discuss more, I was able to get a very different picture. And it's as disappointing as the survey data returned to us. Actually, when I started speaking with people, I got a very different picture. And that was of people who were doing fairly well. This was somebody out in Belk who had built his house and wanted to offer the whole story behind it. And he was not included in the eventual interview data, but he was basically my trigger, that where the light went off and said, okay, actually people do have a story to tell here that I'm not capturing in the data just from this form. So we went on to talk about exceptional cases that came out of these interviews, and many of the people who did want to talk were those who were already doing better. So it's not representative of Ulaanbaatar as a whole. And I think it's important to have that distinction, that the data doesn't say that these people are representative, but it does show what the possibilities are. And as a normative, I'm not about the normative goals, but for policy recommendations, it is important to have these kinds of possibilities that are out there. And the fact that individual plot owners would become homeowners were able to do this, not unlike the family that I was living with, shows something that could be out there and could suggest ways forward for housing in Ulaanbaatar. So this was just a few of the different people that I spoke with who were using their properties for different things. In this case, she was an important example because she was building her home as a base for an economic opportunity. She was going to turn a portion of the house into a stitching factory, and she had enough machines to bring other people in to provide some kind of economic base for her living there, as well as job opportunities for some of the neighbors who would join her in this process. So that was one form of economic opportunity. But a very different one was a fairly inspiring person who was not trained in any kinds of HVAC engineering or any form of engineering at all, but had been very interested in learning about thermal walls and wanting to craft a house that would take very little thermal inputs and maintain its internal temperatures, mostly through sunlight. So having openings in proper places, and then having some kind of wall that was trapped or sealed thermodynamically, both on the exterior and, what I thought oddly, on the interior, but it did manage to work. So these interviews were actually happening in November when it had already been cold out for some weeks, and he had yet to light the stove in this unit. This was a speculative building that he was still constructing at the time. It was also an innovative kind of wall where you can have very low airflow to heat inside here, and then the smoke that does come out gets channeled through this wall before going out. So it's a heating wall, and this wall is a party wall. It's a partition wall between two sides of the house. So it's an internal wall used to heat the space. And he had yet to light this in November. And then the upstairs, again, capturing sunlight in this process. So here's somebody who just learned, autodidact, who figured out a way to start building and wanted to speculatively build more houses this way. And he then became a contributor or a consultant for a number of his neighbors, how to do this form of rigid insulation on the exterior. In this case, actually, it was he was using himself a concrete, a fairly heavy concrete wall. In this case, they're using former railroad ties that had been torn up, so they're turning those into essentially a log type of construction, and they're only doing rigid insulation on the exterior. And he wants to test this. Again, being an autodidact, he wants to go through the process of testing and understanding how well the system works. So those are the different methods of working and trying to gather the information. But really, the heart of this work and where I think the point is that there's a couple of processes that might become generalizable. Most of what I've talked about is fairly specific to this kind of cold weather environment and to Mongolia in particular because of that kind of house. That the ger, this form of tent, is a socially accepted part of life. In fact, it's valorized. If you go out to the countryside, that's the home that I showed you, and bringing that into the city is not looked down upon as some negative form of housing. It's seen as a fairly standard thing, in spite of the fact that everybody or most of the residents do want to upgrade to fixed dwellings. That there isn't a stigma attached to these ger. But there is some sense of gaining a better foothold by having this fixed housing and then also having the yard around it. And the part that I'm curious about, if it could be generalizable, is, it's multiple. The first area that Mongolia has enacted, and I wonder about this for other places, some form of tenure rights and the ability for individuals to be granted automatically, essentially by constitution of the state of Mongolia, the rights to freehold of a particular size property. And this is granted, initially it was 0.07 hectare. Every Mongolian family had the rights to 0.07 hectares of land anywhere in the capital region, or if you go into other urban settlements, what are the provincial capitals, I think it becomes a little over 0.1 hectare, and if you go out to very small settlements, essentially districts within a province, those capitals, I think it's 0.5 hectare of land. And there's another set of rules that applies to the countryside, so non-urbanized areas. So every family under the original land law, I should say that the constitution was written in 1991 after the collapse of state socialism with inputs from a number of other countries, Japan, Korea, and the United States most particularly. And that would lead to a number of the agencies from these places, JICA from Japan, COICA from Korea, and USAID from the United States having inputs. And I'll say a little bit about neoliberalism in a moment, but just know that the World Bank is not working here, but the Asian Development Bank is. So Asian Development Bank has been pretty instrumental in a number of the policies and this shift towards not exactly privatization. So I'll distinguish it from neoliberalism that way. But one of the changes, one of the first changes was the land laws of the about 1996, I believe it was to establish not just that every Mongolian family had this, but eventually there was a case brought to the Supreme Court of Mongolia saying, well, this is in violation of the constitution that we now have that says, actually, rights are individual rights, not family rights. How are we going to rectify this? Well, they changed the land law to then say, actually every individual, every Mongolian individual now has the rights to 0.07 hectare in the capital city. So a space of say 35 by 40 meters leads to 0.14 hectare. So essentially what you're looking at is land that is legitimately available to two people. So two people would be able to acquire this land without any cost and without any tax burden. They can go larger than this, but they would have to pay for the extra amount of land, and they would have to annually pay something in tax to the government. But because of this slippage between the family, the transition from having the laws as a family base to an individual base became a bit of an issue, because there were many families that were restricted to 0.07 hectare. There are others who had extra legally or illegally captured more land without paying for it, who were then amnestied into the new law, which meant that those who had violated the laws actually had a bit of an advantage over those who had followed the laws. So this became a bit of a setup for many, many more people as they're acquiring land to do so a bit beyond the legal measures for so. And Mongolia, I should also mention, being a weak centralized state, that the strength of urban planning, the construction of these former block buildings in the urban core, all came about under Soviet planners, because the Mongolian state had always been fairly weak, and it was only through the strength of Moscow that anything could be enforced. But the state has remained fairly weak in its post-socialist period, and therefore doesn't have a lot of ways of enforcing the kinds of laws that are even on the books. So this sets up one of the kinds of issues, and the dynamic between how much land people capture and use and how much they could potentially do. And this has also led, in this case, one of the members of the family that I was living with, of people going out to the very edge of the city, and now, though he lives in an apartment in that core, one of the slides that I showed you of the very last development under state socialism, he lives in an apartment and owns an apartment in that building, but he too is going out to the edge of the city to capture land according to these rules. And it seems like many of those who need the land least are the ones who understand the rules best to then go out and do this. That version of land law, the 0.07 hectares, it doesn't actually mean ownership. So the tenure that's being given are tenure rights, not ownership of land. All land still remains in the hands of the people of Mongolia as represented by the state. So the government it places itself as caretaker of all the land for all the people of Mongolia. What's being offered to every citizen, and that means the citizen, you know, as soon as a child is born, they can technically have in their name 0.07 hectare, and that's of course what's happening here as well. But it's granted rights, and those rights are also a bit negotiable. Sometimes it's 15 years, sometimes it's 30 years, sometimes it's 70 years. And there's never been any check on this. It's only been going on as a process for about 20 years at this point. It doesn't seem like anyone has lost their rights through the normal means, that the rights are just re-granted for another 15 years when they expire. So the checks on the system have never been tested. But as an idea, it still seems like an interesting possibility of granting people tenure rights, even though the ownership is retained by the state. Sorry, I was going to mention a few more things about where that idea comes from. Now, there was input from USAID towards this. There was input from Asian Development Bank, and maybe in your heads you're starting to think this starting to sound a bit like a neoliberal scheme, Hernan de Soto and the mystery of capital, right? If you make everybody an owner, then suddenly they have wealth. And I'd like to say that that is not what's happening. I think where this scheme comes out of is a very different model, which is the Turkish. In this case, you're seeing an image of Ankara and the Gecekondu settlements, or the overnight built settlements in Ankara, and that happened throughout Turkey. The laws in Turkey were set up, Turkey again imagining itself as an inheritor to some nomadic legacy, set up laws that allowed for people to, if they were able to set up their house within the space of a short time span, to get some kind of control and ownership rights over it. In this case, it is outright ownership of the land that they've settled. But one of the problems has been in Turkey. Turkey's obviously moved on from this kind of settlement, and now going from Gecekondu, which means kind of overnight built, to something called apartment kondu, which is developer driven. Developers coming in, capturing land, putting up apartment blocks in a relatively short amount of time without any permits, without going through the planning process, without going through plan checks, and then retroactively getting those counted through the Gecekondu laws and getting amnesty for those kinds of buildings. So that's one of the potential threats out there as well. But I think it's also been the model for this Mongolian program. Now, the other thing that has been a bit of a model is that idea of private ownership. And so far, Mongolia, I think, has been fairly good in resisting the privatization, and that having that check of government ownership of land, but the granting of rights, and those rights can be bought and sold still, that you can sell your tenure rights with the property that you've built, and somebody else can move in and gain those rights for the remainder of the time frame, and then apply to have those re-upped or revisited for the next 15 years, the next 30 years. So technically under the system that is still possible, and you'll often see houses for sale. The United States, this was in 2011, was trying to set up a secondary mortgage market here. And this is one of those pieces where I worry, and I worry not because it's entirely wrong. I actually worry because a lot of people have been benefiting from this system, but it's also a system. I mean, in 2011, we were coming out of, for those of you who know the U.S. and kind of the world financial crisis of 2008 was really set off by these secondary mortgage markets. So here, my government is going somewhere else and saying, well, we should really be doing this everywhere. And it's something to be, I think, a little bit wary of. On the other hand, those who have done best in the city are, on the one hand, those who took advantage of the laws and kind of went a little bit beyond the laws initially and captured more land. Number two, have been able to get mortgages or take advantage of the various first legal mechanisms and secondary economic mechanisms that cities offer. That this is an urban phenomenon of being able to access a banking system to gain enough funding to build out your house in a fairly short amount of time and then eventually pay that money back. So you're getting your platform for joining the urban economy fairly early by having the house, and with that platform you're able to then earn higher salaries or live a better life, and in turn earn more money that then gets paid back into the system. Okay, and then finally I was going to just have this one note and talk about what planning looks like in a weak centralized state, or where there isn't a lot of centrality to the state and where there are a lot of violations. I think one of the things that the government did set up fairly well is understanding that as a weak state or as a weak centrality, that there wasn't going to be a lot of enforcement of planning laws, so they didn't make many of them. So the difference here is between prescriptive planning, do this, right, follow this line, and proscriptive planning. Instead of having the street with the center line that you follow, you set the edges of the path. You set the where the lines are that you don't go beyond. But anywhere in that space is okay. And mostly this is going towards life safety issues. So technically one is not supposed to be building in intermittently flooding ravines, which as you saw with the topographic map, there's many of those. And one is not supposed to be building under power lines. Right? But of course, people are doing this. But it's a lot easier to police these kinds of encroachments than the overall form of encroachment. So there's going to be new construction that happens throughout the peripheral zones, and there is some policing available to not jeopardize lives. In other words, police towards life safety, but that means mostly moving people out of intermittent stream beds and riverine systems, and secondarily moving them out from under power lines. So setting a proscriptive set of laws rather than the prescriptive kinds of planning. Okay, so I think those few pieces, understanding the within a weak centralized system that you can only do so much, that those who do something are able to build on their own, that people know how to build, but giving them the tools to do so, and those tools, on the one hand, a legal set of constructions, the land laws, and on the other hand, access to something like mortgages. I'm wondering if those are more generalizable. In other words, would it be possible in Ahmedabad to supply greater housing capacity, not by building more homes, but by allowing people to build their homes and giving them those kinds of economic, legal tools and some kinds of general parameters. So that's where I was hoping to have those of you who are interested in participating in a discussion about this contributing something. Any thoughts so far to those ideas? I am going to pass.
Thank you very much for the presentation. I think I have never really sat through a presentation about Mongolia, and I've not even read anything about it. That's what interested me, and that was why I was here. Of course, we can see some similarities in terms of the informal housing that's being built. I mean, in our context, we would say that this kind of informal housing, which is later on getting little kind of regularized, and the informal housing that you have in India. But the Indian market also, you have a strong financial system which allows people to access the finance market and the mortgage market, both at the levels of where it is high loans and where you have formal housing, especially for apartments and public such kind of houses. And also the houses which are in informal sector, the houses which are in slums or areas which are not regulated or which are not accepted by the law, you also have a small mechanism which is the microfinance which is available for those people, and they can sort of upgrade their houses. So it's happening in the Indian housing market. The problem here is that the demand is so large as compared to what we see in Mongolia. I'm sure in India, if there was these so-called land plots being given by the government, they would be on sale at a premium even before they were allotted. So there's that kind of demand in the Indian market. So that would be a little different from the Mongolian market. So there are some similarities and there are some differences. I'm slightly interested in knowing, provided that land parcels are given, does the government also give them any access to water supply, sanitation, or things like that, or they have to fend for themselves?
Yeah. Okay. So, say a few things about that because it is it's a really important question in all of this, which is, again, a fairly weak central city government does not have a lot of economic basis to do this, and especially if they're not collecting much in taxes. And when I talk about the taxes, I should also probably point out that these are residential land taxes, whereas commercial properties, they are still being taxed. So I think that's actually one of the better ideas in this process, is that allowing those who can afford it the least to not or to be absolved of most of the taxes, whereas properties that can't afford it, they are collecting the taxes, and that is the basis for a lot of the revenue. But there isn't a lot in the coffers to begin with. And what the city tends to provide is some regularization of the roads, which doesn't always mean paving, although it eventually tends to mean paving. And there is bus service that comes out here, regardless of whether it's paved or not. There tends to be bus service. The city has been fairly good about then supplying street lighting at night. Electricity is an easier one to get to each of these places in the city. That one's a bit negotiable because there are electricians who will simply put in wiring and connect people in their individual yard to the urban system. But there's more and more of that happening from the city side, so in a formal way, with metering, that there is metering that's happening now. And there's an interesting caveat to that as well, which is that it used to be that most of the city had centralized heating. All of those regularized socialist block buildings were all connected to a single power plant that provided heating, which incidentally came on September 15th. So heating in the city turns on September 15th and turns off, I think, something like April 15th or May 15th. But now with something like, I mentioned 1.3 million people here, almost 40% of that population is living in these informal settlements now and are not connected to that centralized heating. So that means that each of these families has a cook fire that's burning coal, which has created terrible smog for this valley. So one of the programs has been to not count the metering that happens from the evening hours when people would be cooking, and to try and encourage more families to use slower burning stoves for heating their tent, which you can't cook on, but to cook on an electric surface. So that's part of the interest of the city, to supply more of the electricity infrastructure to more families to alleviate some of the coal burning. Water, however, is not supplied, and that's a really difficult one because it's costly to get there. You'd have to put in the pipes, you'd have to build out the system, and there isn't a lot of water available. And these families here are not using a lot right now. If they were getting regularized plumbing, they'd be using a lot more, and that water may not be available. So what they are doing is trucking in tank water to a central distribution point. People bring their own buckets or their own containers and bring it home that way. So that, then I could also talk a bit about services, the kind of schools and education, hospitals. There are some clinics being built, there are some schools being built, but that's also been one of these areas where a number of homes, once you build your house, that's an opportunity to open a small school, a creche, you know, a primary school or some kind of education place for the neighborhood kids. That's been seen as an economic opportunity that the state or the government, the municipal government does not supply, that people are able to do for themselves here.
I've just got a question about, I didn't see the first couple of slides of your presentation, but the topology, you know, with the 0.75, almost an acre, reminds me very much of the traditional topology from the country I come from, which is Ireland, where you'd have had an acre and a bit like an Indian bungalow, you'd have had a low-rise thatched cottage. And there are some problems with that topology, which is that it's very low-rise, it's not compact, and it's not particularly sustainable in the sense of gathering together and sharing your party wall. It just seems to me very interesting that these nomadic people are building things which are kind of objects in the landscape, which look a little bit, I mean, they're square versions of the circular, yeah, I think it was that photograph that you had, the first one, where you just see this little, exactly, yeah. I mean, a bit like in Switzerland. So I had a question about, are there any other topologies in the cities or the towns in Mongolia which are denser or where buildings gather together, or are they really, really fixated on the isolated house, home?
Yeah.
Sorry.
No, I think that's quite good, and it's a relevant question, obviously. It's quite important to understand why this. And I think a lot of this imagery, and you don't see it so much in some of the simpler ones that I've shown, but I've actually been going around documenting much more ornate ones that resemble Russian dachas. The dacha house has been taken as something that has really informed much of the city, and it really goes back to late 19th century. The first foreign buildings were either Chinese style temples they were Mongolian temples, Buddhist centers, but they took on the formal aspects of a Chinese temple. And outside of ecclesiastic architecture, the only real model then became Russian housing. A number of Russian traders built their houses here, and that really captured the imagination. And I think under the period of Soviet domination of Mongolia during the socialist period, there was quite a bit of that, and it was seen that that was the form of housing outside of the high-rise apartment block. So that's become a thing, but now I believe what these Gare districts are trying to do is negotiate some kind of third space, third landscape that was not the khut, the city, which had its associations with trade, with the ecclesiastic, with all these different reasons for cities coming about, and not the, so between the khut and the hudu, the countryside, that they wanted to have the amenities of the city and still capture a very small portion of the countryside. And this is part of that valorization of the gare that's sitting out on the plains. This idea, they still want this, and they want the other thing at the same time. So this landscape of the kind of Gare district really is negotiating a new third space, and they're taking advantage of it in many ways. I mean, yes, it is slow, it is low rise, and that causes a lot of problems, but it also has its advantages as well. Which is that these become spaces for economic opportunity that you don't have in the apartment blocks. And the people I was, actually this larger family that I was documenting and living with, tended to be growing crops. They were actually using a lot of the land that they'd captured amongst all the different family members. They were able to string together a number of different parcels and get an economy of scale on this land and grow different kinds of crops, food crops, as well as trees that they sold to the city. But a number of other opportunities are there in these peripheral areas, which is the wood shops, the metal shops, car repair often happened here because they needed a bit more land. You couldn't do that within the city center. So it has its problems of sprawl, absolutely. And it has its Malthusian tendencies of, you know, burning too much coal and being a little bit too far, and you have to string up more power lines, and you can't affordably, or the city can't affordably put in the plumbing lines to get there. But it does give some of those economic advantages that they had moved to the city for to begin with. So it's always a bit of a negotiation. Yes, it is the advantages of suburbia, but in real economic terms, I mean, they are using these chasha yards to do something other than simply having the land as well. But I think there's also that symbolic having the land that's important.
I'm just thinking, is tourism also considered as a form of economic opportunity, and this tourism?
Tourism?
Yeah, and does this kind of houses, do they actually contribute towards enriching the experience of tourism or something like that?
That's a good question.
I can't say I've ever had that question before on this. So I'll think this through. Generally, tourists are told to avoid the Gare districts, that they're dangerous. I've been robbed a number of times in Ulaanbaatar and never in a Gare district. Of course, it's in the city center where the tourists tend to congregate. I've had all kinds of different issues, and it's always been in the city center, not here. But I think there's a slight sense of that slum tourism that happens here, that people might see it and say, oh, we're out in the Gare districts. But I would guess that that's a very small proportion of tourism. Tourism is an important part of Ulaanbaatar's economy. The general economy for Mongolia, which is probably relevant to mention here, I mentioned that half the country remains in that pastoral nomadic system of production. So herding and then getting the wool from this, sheep and some, actually a significant amount of goat wool now, cashmere. That was a real function of the late 90s when cashmere became a real substance that people wanted, and then it really crashed the prices when Mongolia kind of took over too much land to do this. So that's an economic means for about half the country's population, but it represents a very small proportion of GDP terms. That's mostly because of, even before, say, 5-6 years ago, so much of the economy was based on a few single exports, copper and coal, and now even more copper, more coal, some gold, Mongolia. I mean, the Mongolia's economic transformation in the last, say, 5 to 6, maybe 7 years. 7 years ago, there was a real jump in economic activity, and all of it was speculative. All of it was based on Mongolia potentially possessing the largest copper mine in the world. That would also, copper tends to come with gold, so it would have the added benefit of a lot of gold production, and having an enormous coal reserve very close to the border of China. And China was looking very enthusiastically and already, though the government of Mongolia tends not to very quickly react to these kinds of things, I think they're still trying to negotiate on building a rail line from where the mines are going to open to a border. China, within the space of a few months, actually built a whole connection, I mean, across a vast territory, to put a rail line right up to the border, just the opposite where these mines are going to open up. And the Mongolian side, for it's been like a decade now that they've been dragging on about these negotiations for putting in the rail line on their side. But copper has been a huge boon to the economy, but also to this kind of speculative thing. So tourism had represented a larger share of the economy until the most recent mining activities came online. And the tourism has definitely grown in real terms, but in GDP percentage, it has shrunk. So is there a possibility out here? Yeah, actually, I think there is. And that would be one of the other opportunities that people have here, is something like the Airbnb version, except the air, I don't know, what do you call it, gare and breakfast. And there has been some activity towards small-scale enterprises like that. I mean, I would fit that in with the same kind of economic activity that happens with, say, people opening small schools in these areas, the auto shops. It's part of this informal economic activity that could happen there, which is important. I mean, it's definitely, in the kind of neoclassical economic viewpoint, having more and more of this informality allows for more vitality, right? More economic vitality. On the other hand, there is that Malthusian or neo-Malthusian threat that happens with sprawl, with the burning of more coal, the very little access to water. So that's the dynamic that maybe your question plays within.
So this is kind of a whole informal districts, which maybe are somehow similar in not the physical form, but other kinds of activities to say favelas or something like that. But here you can say the state is supporting it.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, it begins with that. The state provides the land and then people go about doing their activities. So in this kind of, when you have this kind of informal structure where the state supports and then the settlements develop there, is there also a market for this land? Do informal land transactions happen? Do informal, I mean, at what cost? And I don't know if you can tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, okay, so the positives of that are that there is economic opportunity in the transferring of these land rights, the usufruct rights or the tenure rights. And there has been some capacity for people to build economic opportunity for themselves through that. But as I was also trying to point out, it's often the wrong people that are doing that. Not wrong, I mean, I like the fact that anybody has access to it, but it's those with the best knowledge of how urban systems work. Usually, I mean, the people that I interviewed, when I would go around and interview and ask about, what about other land that you're not living on, but that you're trying to capture and develop and register in the name of your children, very few Gare district dwellers were doing that. Capture. Well, yeah. Well, registering it, having it registered in official documents. And the people who were doing that were people who lived in fixed dwellings in the urban core, in apartments.
It was familiar with the formal systems on table.
Familiar with the formal systems, yeah. So the greater familiarity they had with the formal systems, the better advantage they had in this. So that's the downside of this, is this, the advantage isn't entirely going to the right group of people. And I can also point out that economic disparity has grown in Mongolia. Part of it, it's the mining and all this economic activity around the mining. Part of it's just the post-socialist transition, that those with the best access to power also ended up with the best access to financial resources and grew those resources. So from the socialist period, if you looked at the Gini coefficient for Mongolia, it was pretty low in post-socialist, or just in that the end of the socialist period. Everybody was really poor. I mean, it's not that everybody was at the same level, it was just everybody was at the same level quite low, and some have really accelerated out of it and many have not. So the generally, if you looked at it at a GDP per capita basis, it would look like everyone's doing much better. And many people will tell you that. Even those who aren't doing so well, they'll say, no, it's much better than socialism. That was like, you know, that almost killed us. And the post-socialist era almost really finished us off. Now we're doing a lot better with all the economic activity coming to our country. But they are able to look around and say, how come those people are doing so much better than I am now? So there is that spread. And you're starting to see traces of this in the politics. I'm not a specialist at all in the Mongolian political system, but you are starting to see a politics come into this of economic disparities as well.
I just had this, since you mentioned that it's a nomadic society, and of course, it's no well known. But post-socialists, whatever little I've read, most of these post-socialist societies, I mean, because of the collapse of socialism, I believe, as far as I understand, in the rural areas, there has been more of a push factor, and due to which the people are shifting now to, or there is an aspiration to go to urban areas to look out for opportunities, rather than urban areas acting as a pull. So it's more of a push. So in that sense, when you say many of them are unable to participate in this urban so-called economy, it's bound to occur, isn't it? Because there is a lack of skills to participate in that urban economy. So they do come because obviously there is no option in rural, so they have to, or there is not much opportunity in the rural, so, and so to urban is the place to come to. But then to participate in urban is really not possible. And that is why maybe so-called the elite are capturing or being able to capture all the opportunities that exist in urban. So to that extent, I don't know, is the government really thinking of providing any such other opportunities in the sense, apart from land, is there an attempt to build skills or other kinds of employment support or social security measures? Is there anything in place? Because for that translation to happen, that would be necessary. Otherwise, just providing land, the land would always be taken away, as Madhu pointed out. There'd be somebody else who could capitalize on land.
Good, that's a fantastic question. Yes, I completely agree that housing is not a problem just of housing. It's embedded within an entire set of economic realities. I'll qualify your question a little bit, because my findings were that yes, it's been a lot of push factors at various points in the last 25 years since the end of socialism. But actually, at the moment, I would say there's a lot of pull factors that are more involved in bringing rural to urban migrants. There was a time after the collapse of socialism where they divided up the herds and every herder got a set number of animals, and everybody was given equal, and then this there's a lot of discourse around that issue on all sides. Everybody kind of pointing fingers at what went wrong with that. Some people saying the successful herders, so many people lost their herds in that time, and the successful ones said, well, those guys didn't know how to herd to begin with. You should have never given them the animals, and all they did was cause more problems for those of us who do know how to herd, because they're creating desertification. Those who lost their herds were saying, well, actually, you didn't give us a viable number. We actually needed, if you'd given us just a few more, then we would have finally become viable. But you know, until we reach that, we're going to collapse anyway. And there is desertification happening, and the fingers are being pointed at each other and at the Chinese and the Chinese factories and at the rest of the world for causing climate change. So there are a lot of issues in negotiation, but that was a period of a lot of push, that because they were no longer viable in a rural setting, if you don't have animals, you can't live there. And that's what pushed a lot of people in. Now it's become a bit stable in the rural areas, that in some ways, I always hesitate to use these terms, but it does seem to reflect a reality that there's a carrying capacity to the rural landscape, how many animals it'll support, and with that, how many people. And what the change has been is that there's usually an excess of labor, often an excess of female labor in the rural areas. So it's often the women that are coming to the urban centers, but actually because of education, that they are being pulled in because of education, and they tend to get better, higher paying jobs and being able to support their families. And then those are families that will retire to the peripheral areas. And I was surprised actually how many of the families in going around and doing the survey had only come there recently and with some stability because their daughter was living in the city and was able to provide for them. So they basically gave up their nomadic lifestyle just to be around their daughter and hoping that their daughter was going to then provide grandchildren or something like that. So there was a lot of pull. And I would say that's become a more dominant narrative. But your overall question still stands, that yes, there needs to be more economic opportunity. And there hasn't been a lot of provision of that from the government level. There is something of that neoliberalist approach where they're handing it off and saying, well, you Australian and Canadian mining companies develop more mines. In that, we'll specify that you have to hire this many low-wage workers, this many Mongolian, middle-wage, this many high-wage, meaning educated. And they have pushed for those specifications. So there are more and more engineers getting, or Mongolians getting engineering degrees, more Mongolians getting some kind of mid-level set of skills for driving trucks and things like that, all around mining, but that's a single sector. And I think there's a real worry about something like Dutch disease, the a single economic sector sucking up all of the potential talent and changing the price levels and Mongolian trade of the what's called the tugruk, the Mongolian currency against foreign currencies, and then really causing something devastating in all the other sectors. I don't know that the Mongolian government has done a good job of promoting any other kinds of jobs than the ones that foreign companies are bringing in. So I think that's going to remain one of the challenges. But there's, in some ways, I want to offer the GER districts as glimmers of hope, right? It's not everyone's benefiting from it, but having the opportunity to start your auto body shop or repairs or really all the wood furniture that's made for Ulaanbaatar happens out here, a lot of the metal work. There aren't the larger scale industries that had existed under socialism. There were larger scale industries then. All of that evaporated. So now it's at the home-based industry or the small scale industries, and those are out in the GER districts because that's where they have the space to do this, the land to do this, and a pool of labor resources to do it.
Yeah. It's actually regarding, I read a book about 2 years ago, it's called Wolf Totem, in which they mentioned that the balance, you said desertification is happening here, the balance was maintained in terms that there were equal amount of wolves which would block the overgrazing to happen. So are you saying that there has been a serious decline in the wildlife, as in terms of biodiversity, like in the wolf life? Because in the book it came out like that, so I just wanted to clarify that.
I have to say I've heard of the book, but I've never read it. I don't know the contents. So just based on your question, wildlife and diversity in the rural areas has been in decline for centuries. It accelerated under state socialism as they tried to collectivize. I think that was probably a low point for rural landscapes was the 1930s attempt at collectivization, and then again in the late 1950s, early 1960s was a second attempt at collectivization. But there is a strong sense of wildlife conservation that's come up in the last decade or so as Mongolia's gotten through that post-socialist transition and people did become a little bit more stable and there was some economic basis to do so, and a lot of foreign NGOs entered to the picture. They've set up a lot of wildlife reserves throughout the country, but it's not an area I can really speak to. It's all what I've been surrounded by because I would often, if you fly in or out of Mongolia, you tend to be around a lot of NGO type people. I used to take the train there when I was a poorer student and be around Mongolians a lot more. And then I got to meet all the foreign mining engineers and also all the foreign NGO people as I started to fly. And I would just hear these stories from them. So it's from what I hear, it sounds like that picture is getting better, but it's been in decline for a long time, so I just don't have a good way of answering that. Yeah. Any last? I'll give you the last question.
So actually, I would like to know from a legal point of view, for example, there are ancestral transfer of property law is there. For example, in India, the ancestral property is divided into sons, father. So regarding that property or the area, 0.14 hectare, it is for that, or if that person who is living in that, having two sons, how it would be transferred?
Yeah. Okay, that's also a really good question, and I can only answer that to some degree, which is that the intention is that yes, it would be transferable in the same way that it's saleable, that you can buy and trade in these properties, you can also then inherit the rights to using that land, but of course the ownership would still stay with the state. And the idea is that land, should the population shrink or decrease in an area, that the government still has the ability to cancel those kinds of contracts on whenever it becomes due, especially if it's not the original person who registered that land. The government wanted to have that built into it, but the part that I can't answer is the kind of going forward, how it's actually going to be practiced, because so many of these contracts have yet to come due. There has been a bit of turnover, you know, people have died in the last 15, 20 years. There has been some transference, there have been many sales, but the longer term picture, it's hard to know, because that experiment just hasn't run yet.
Yeah. There's a question arises, where's the death of the person or the head of that area is on the name of that person?
The debt.
Who will claim that property or that land?
Oh, there. Well, that would come under a. Well, that would be a different set of legal regimes that are in place towards inheritance rights, which. Land in this case, or the land rights, would just fall into a kind of property the same way bank accounts or any other kind of property would. And that would be decided through inheritance laws. It's an entire legal area I have very little knowledge about. But yes, it can be transferred to a particular person. Would they split it? I couldn't answer. I just wouldn't know that. But it can be transferred, and it can be revoked eventually by the state as it becomes due. Yeah. Okay. Well, very last question. Yeah. Okay.
Just a quick. Have you come across any instances where these so-called not actually beneficiaries, but these right holders having multiple homes, say in the rural as well as the urban? Because just after the earthquake in a similar, at least the geographical context in Kutch, we found here in Gujarat, that when there was an opportunity, many of these people in Kutch who were nomadic actually established multiple homes. When they had one in the urban so that they could get those benefits, they had that opportunity of building a home through a state-sponsored thing, and at the same time continued to maintain their homes in rural areas. So have you come across any such?
Yeah. The answer is yes, I have come across that. It is really interesting. Not in a great degree. There's still a large housing demand, so there aren't a lot of properties that sit vacant for very long. If someone gets the property, there's usually someone who's going to be moving into that property. Maybe not themselves. Maybe they will be renting it out to someone else. But I do know of people who have been doing that, where this was not part of my research at all, but a friend who was living in the apartment of her father, because in the apartment of her mother, her sisters had always lived, and she knew that they would get the rights to that, whereas her father had no other, her sisters had other fathers, she knew that there was no one else that could inherit that, but she didn't want to lose the opportunity by not living there. And there was, this actually goes back a little bit to the socialist mindset. I mean, this was a system under socialism. It's meant to not be the case now, but I think there's a real worry that that it could still happen that way. So she's been living in the home of her father with that in mind. And I mean, her father knows this as well. He wants her living there so that she inherits it and it doesn't return to the state. Because he had been granted this apartment because he had gained it through the socialist system, being a good worker. He was granted the apartment. And I think there's still this fear on his part that the state takes it back. And he didn't want that by establishing that his daughter was living there. So in that case, yes. And even some of the people I was living with, the one I showed, they were going out to, quote unquote, capture the land by staking their 0.07 hectare based on newborn children in the family, that it would be theirs one day, sort of, it would just be part of the families, but they had the right to do that because the law says that it's all speculative land in that sense. So yeah, I think there is that strong possibility out there. Anyway, thank you all for joining this. I appreciate your coming out, and I appreciate all the really great questions for this. So thank you. And again, thank you, Chandra Ma.